There was a Bhikshu like that in the past. The Bhikshu wearing red clothing went to the home of a goldsmith. The goldsmith at the time was making a pearl necklace for the king of the country. Each pearl of the strand was extremely costly. While the Bhikshu was in the goldsmith's home, the goldsmith lost of the pearls and accused the Bhikshu of having stolen it. Actually, the Bhikshu did know where the pearl was, but he certainly had not stolen it. Where was the pearl? Because the Bhikshu had been wearing red colored clothing, the pearl had reflected the red color. Right at that time, the ghost had come in, and when it saw a pearl reflecting the red color, it looked to the ghost like a piece of meat. And so the ghost seized it in its beak and gulped it down. Thereupon, the Bhikshu had reflected, "If I say the pearl has been eaten by the goldsmith will certainly kill the ghost to get back the pearl. If that happens, it will be as if I indirectly had killed the goose." Therefore, he hadn't said where the pearl was. The goldsmith said, "Now, there are only two of us here, and since my pearl is missing, you must have stolen it. If you hadn't stolen it, how could it be missing?" The Bhikshu said he hadn't stolen it. The goldsmith grabbed a cane and started beating the Bhikshu, yelling, "So you didn't steal it, you're just not admitting it." He kept beating him until the Bhikshu's body was entirely covered with welts, his skin broken and bleeding. When the Bhikshu had been beaten to the point that he bled, the goose, seeing the blood, ran up and started drinking the blood that was flowing from the Bhikshu's body. The goldsmith hadn't expected the goose to run and drink the blood and was still using his cane to beat the Bhikshu. One blow of his cane smashed the goose's head and the goose died of the blow. Once it was dead, the Bhikshu said, "You shouldn't beat me. Now you can find your pearl." The goldsmith said, "I can find it? Can I? You stole it, and now you better come up with it fast. If not, I'll beat you to death." The Bhikshu said, "The pearl was eaten by the goose. Now that you have beaten the goose to death, I'm telling you, the pearl is in the goose belly. If you don't believe me, you can split open the goose stomach and you will find the pearl." As it turned out, when the goldsmith cut open the goose belly, the pearl actually was inside the goose stomach. When the goldsmith saw that, he realized this Bhikshu is someone who really holds the precepts. In order to protect the goose's life, no matter how much I beat him, he wouldn't say anything. But in fact, the goose had eaten the pearl. He informed the king of the country of what had happened, and the king was very respectful of the Bhikshu. That is what is meant by a mind which is able to bear and endure. There is another story, this time about a group of Bhikshus, quite a few of them, who while traveling through a stretch of wilderness were held up by bandits. The bandits robbed the Bhikshus of their valuables and also robbed them of all their clothing so that they had no clothes to wear. Some of the bandits suggested, "We should kill these left-home people. If they aren't killed, they'll probably report us to the king and it won't go well for us. It would be better to kill them." Other bandits said, "Don't kill them. The law of Bhikshus is that not only do they not harm the lives of living beings, they are not even permitted to harm the lives of plants and trees. Let's tie these Bhikshus up in the rushes. That way they won't be able to report us to the king and no one will fight us." The other bandits thought it over and said, "That's a good plan. It would be best to tie them up in the rushes and have them die on their own." So the bandits bound the Bhikshus in the rushes and then went on their way. When they had gone, an elder amongst the bishops said, "We should now recognize that in the past we robbed people of their valuables and took people's life. And so this life we have met this with this retribution. So all of you bear up under this." He talked to them like that. Then at dusk, the ants and beetles and mosquitoes and all the rest came to bite them. They beat the bishops to the point that their entire bodies were one huge blister, which was both painful and itchy. The elder bishop said, "Everyone bear with it. Don't become hateful. See how the dragons, because of giving rise to hatred by cultivating the way, fell to the bodies of dragons. Although we have now encountered this difficulty, we should have no hate to avoid ending up like the dragons. When the dragons lose their hatred, then they will be able to abandon the bodies of dragons and resume cultivating. So everyone be patient." The more he spoke that way, the more trouble there was. Bees came to sting them, everything imaginable came to bite them, and their bites were extremely difficult to endure. During the night, the host of the wolves, bears, panthers, and leopards terrified the bishops incredibly. Then at daybreak, who should appear but the king of the country conducting a hunting expedient right through the area where the bishops were. When he saw them from afar, the king thought that they were wild beasts since the bishops were not wearing clothes. As he approached and saw them better, the king thought they must be goblins. As he got even closer and was within speaking distance, upon questioning them, he found out that they were bishops who had been robbed of all their possessions by bandits, and in consideration of holding the precepts, were enduring hunger and thirst rather than consenting to harm the grass and bushes. When the king saw those bishops were that way, he felt great respect for them and said, "In my country, there are still bishops who cultivate the way like that. This is truly rare." The king immediately released them from the rushes, and in which they had been tied, and invited them to return with him to the palace to accept offerings from him. "All of you think it over. All people had to do was tie the bishops up with rushes. Yet they would not consent to break the precepts and harm the rushes. They were prepared to endure starvation and being stung to death by insects rather than break the precepts. See what kind of ability they had to bear what is difficult to bear and practice what is difficult to practice. Precepts with which it was impossible to keep, they were able to keep. That is to be genuine Dharma and Sangha draws within Buddhism, and that is the mind which is able to endure a tamed and subdued mind, not to speak of taming and subduing the minds of others. It is not easy to tame and subdue one's own mind. You tell it to cultivate the way, yet all it does is strike up false thinking. As soon as you want to cultivate the way, there are even more false thoughts. You want to become purer, and justified thoughts multiply. It is not easy to tame and subdue one's mind. If you are able to tame and subdue that mind which is so stubborn and disobedient, then you have some skill. That have a still and quiet mind does not mean that the external environment is still and quiet, but rather that one is still and quiet within one's own mind. Within one's own mind, there is no sound whatsoever. A completely good mind is a mind without the slightest evil. An unmixed and unscattered mind is when one's mind is unconfused and undispersed, with no admixtures. The opposite of a mind with no hankering or yearning would be, for instance, if you gave something away and then afterwards regretted it. A vast mind is expansive and broad. A great mind means the very greatest mind there is. Nothing is greater. The Bodhisattva using those 10 minds attains entry to the second ground of living filth. The Bodhisattva, by employing those 10 kinds of profound minds in cultivation, can attain to the second ground and leave all defiling filth far behind. Disciples of the Buddha, Varachajari Bodhisattva again calls out, "All of you disciples of the Buddha, when the Bodhisattva dwells upon the ground of living filth, his nature of itself leaves all killing far behind. He does not collect knives or staffs. He himself does not collect, but he does not retain or prepare knives, staffs, or any instruments of killing. He does not cherish resentment or hatred. The Bodhisattva has not resentment or hatred in his mind for anyone. He has shame and he has remorse. He is endowed with humanness and reciprocity. This means that one does not subject others to what one would not want to be subjected to oneself. For instance, if you would not want others to oppress you, then you yourself do not oppress other people. If you yourself would not like to be scolded by people, then you do not scold others. Those are all minds of humanness and reciprocity. Humanness means being kind and compassionate towards people, and reciprocity also means a sense of forgiveness. No matter who does that, what wrong, you forgive them. He is endowed with his mind of human love, this mind of reciprocity and forgiveness. Towards all living beings who have a life with regard to all living beings with a sentience, that is, all living beings who have blood and breath and so have lives. He always brings forth thoughts of benefit and kindly mindfulness. He always wants to benefit all those living beings and be kind and compassionate towards all people. This Bodhisattva would not, with evil mind, even trouble living beings. He would not maliciously cause living beings to become afflicted, how much the less give rise to healthy intent and utterly kill or harm any whom he realizes are living beings, being aware that they are living beings. He would not employ a heavily evil mind and then carry out that heavy intent to kill or harm living beings. Because they are living beings, one should have an attitude of humanness and reciprocity towards them. One should not kill and harm them. Sutra, his nature does not steal. The Bodhisattva is always content with his own possessions. He is always kind and forgiving towards others and does not wish to encroach upon them. If an item belongs to someone else, he gives rise to the thought that it is someone else's item and would never consider stealing it. Down to a blade of grass or a leaf, if not given, he does not take it, how much the less any other of the necessities of life. Commentary, his nature does not steal. The second ground, the ground of living filth, is also the ground of the purity of the self nature, and it is one's basic undefined self nature. Within that kind of state, one's own nature is free from all defined dharmas, to the point that every state of mind and every movement of thought is pure with no defilement. If you have one single defined thought, that is impurity. The principles expounded in the Flower Dharma Sutra are all dharma doors which are not separate from our daily activities and concerns. Not only are the principles of the Flower Dharma Sutra not separate from the daily route of our ordinary activities, but the other sutras also are not apart from the principles which we require in our daily behavior. If the principles discussed by the sutras had no relevance to the daily lives of each and every one of us, the Buddha would not have spoken those sutras. The Buddha spoke the sutras to enable each of us to live good lives, proper and regular lives, lives very much in accordance with the rules. That is why he spoke all of the Dharma doors and lectured all the sutras. Each sutra is presenting us with a proper road along which to travel. However, we must go along it for the sutras to be of use. If we only know the sutras and do not rely upon the sutras to cultivate, then we can listen to the sutras for 80,000 great compass, but it will be equivalent to not having heard them at all. And so, they had eyes but did not see Nishyanda Buddha, had ears but did not hear the perfect Satin teaching. It could be explained in this way. All who were listening to the sutras listened for a while and then fell asleep. And so they had eyes but they did not see and had ears but did not hear. Therefore, the first requirement for all of you now listening to the Flower of Dharma Sutra is not to fall asleep. If you fall asleep, then you too have eyes but do not see Nishyanda, have ears but do not hear the perfect Satin teaching. That's the first requirement. The second requirement is not to dream. If you fall asleep, that is not so important, but the dreaming is. A man has a dream, and in his dream, he sees his girlfriend come. A girl has a dream, and in her dream, she sees her boyfriend arrive. Who did you say that was to kick the Flower of Dharma Sutra right out beyond the ninth heaven? Then, when he wakes up, he keeps looking for his girlfriend. She just came. Where can she have gone? Oh, I saw her come. He has the dream, and then after waking from the dream, he still wants to look for his girlfriend. Men look for girlfriends and women for boyfriends, saying, I saw my boyfriend. Now, where has he gone to? Looking all over the place, if it's that way, then it doesn't matter whether I lecture the Flower of Dharma Sutra well or not, you won't understand it. But if you are not asleep and not dreaming, then even if I don't lecture well, you can still completely savor its flavor till you are in your element and understand more principle. So return to the sutra text. His nature does not steal. Of the nature, it is said, people at first are basically good. In nature, they are close to the nature, yet learn to be distant. If they are not touched, their nature then shifts. The teaching of principles merit concentration. This is a quote from the three character class. At one time, in China, every child could recite it, but it's not well known at all in America, so I shall explain it for you. People at first means people when they have just been born are basically good in nature. Their natures are good. Some claim that our natures are evil, but the nature being evil won't stand up. It says that in nature they are good. Basically, they are good. They are close to the nature. Their natures basically are close to the good. Their natures are just about the same as our original nature and are far distant from it, yet learn to be distant. They learn to be distant from the basic nature. If they are not taught, if you do not instruct them, their nature then shifts. Those who were good in nature become evil natured, which is the meaning of their natures then shifting. The teaching of principles merits concentration. When you teach them principles, how should you do it? It merits concentration. You should concentrate on the teaching. Now in America, the children are supposed to develop spontaneously and naturally, and so they do whatever they please. the way this way this turns out that they are like trees with branches forking off to the north, south, east, and west, and pausing between. That greatly decreases the uses to which the basic trunk of the tree can be put, so that it cannot become good quality building material. As a result, a great many American children have become hippies, and this is the form of improper instruction. His nature does not steal. When the Bodhisattva holds the precept against stealing, not only does he not break the precept in a tangible way, but he also does not violate it in intangible ways. This means he does not violate the precepts in ways that can be seen or known, and even when it could not be seen or found out, he still does not violate the precepts in his nature. That is, there is no use of stealing in it. The analogy is that of making bread or biscuits. If you are making bread and you don't add any yeast, it won't be easy to get the dough to rise, and basically it won't rise. But if you do add yeast, the dough will rise and you can make bread or biscuits. The yeast is like stealing. If there is none of that yeast in one's nature, then there will be no stealing. The Bodhisattva is always content with his own possessions. The Bodhisattva himself constantly knows how to be satisfied with his own possessions, his internal valuables of head, eyes, brains, and marrow, and his outer valuables of countries, cities, wives, and children. As it is said, if one knows how to be content, one is always happy. Why do we steal? It's because we are not satisfied and greedy without stop. If you know how to be content, then you are always content. If you know how to be content, then you will not be humiliated. If you know when to stop, then you will not get into trouble. If you can always be content, then you will not break the law, nor will people look down on you. You will not be humiliated, means no one will come along and humiliate you. If you know when to stop, then you will not get into trouble. If you ordinarily have no greed, then there will be no dangers at all. Trouble means danger. As it is also said, if you know how to be content, then you are always happy. If you know how to be patient, then you are peaceful of yourself.